day and night. I laid there until the devil was gone. Until Kevin Sullivan was gone from superstar Billy Graham. Now I'm alive and well, and I've come back to get you, Kevin Sullivan.
This is Championship Wrestling from Florida. And now, the award-winning voice of Championship Wrestling is chosen by the Florida Sportscasters Association, Gordon Solie.
Welcome to Championship Wrestling from Florida. I want to know about this camp. We've got some very special guests coming up a little bit later on to tell you all about the very exciting Miami Grand Prix upcoming. Now then, Buddy Cole is with me, and Buddy, the Road Warriors are on their way.
Yes, they are. Boy, I'll tell you, I'm excited to see them coming back to Florida again.
Indeed, and they have a special mission. But right now, let's go back to the completion of this match. The Road Warriors facing Mr. Sullivan and his entire group. And as you can see here, this is the incident, by the way, where the spike was confiscated by the Road Warriors. And obviously, Mr. Sullivan is very intent upon regaining that golden spike.
That's right. It seems like the golden spike really has a lot of meaning to Kevin Sullivan and his motley crew of Bob Roop, the Purple Haze, and it seems like he has Abdul the Butcher hanging around with him now, and he is really definitely intent on getting that golden spike back. That seems to be a must with Sullivan to regain that spike, but I'll tell you, if he gets that back from the Road Warriors, he's really done something.
He has indeed. The Road Warriors here, the Animal and the Hawk, under the management of Precious Paul Ellering. As I said, of course, they will be returning to Florida, and now you see the situation as it erupts outside of the ring. By the way, we're expecting momentarily a call from the president of the NWA, Mr. Bob Geigel. Hopefully that will come through while we are still on the air regarding the suspension of one Blackjack Mulligan. There you see it's Blackjack Mulligan charging into the ring. In fact, he is the one, as you watch very carefully now, he is the one who upends the Purple Haze. And ultimately, this results in the golden spike, rather, going to the into the hands of the Road Warriors themselves. They are still in possession of that golden spike, and Sullivan and Hayes. It appears to me that Sullivan is going to be in a great deal of difficulty with Abuda Dean if he doesn't get that spike back. But the Road Warriors, the Animal and the Hawk, two of the most awesome competitors in professional wrestling, returning to Florida. Wait just a second. We've got a yellow. Okay, well, that was, pardon me just a second, all right, that we saw the Road Warriors, and I do have Bob Geigel on the phone right now. Yeah. Yes, sir. All right, let me explain to the audience, because apparently our patch isn't working or something here, but let me explain to the audience what's going on right now. All right, the suspension against Blackjack Mulligan has been lifted. Okay. A what? Here was the incident that occurred. Yeah, all right. All right, Mr. Dino. I see. Mulligan then reached an agreement with you, agreed to drop the lawsuit. He agreed to drop the lawsuit. Here. Okay. All right. Well, let me explain that to the folks here. Thank you, sir. Okay, Mr. Geigel, thank you very much. Bob Geigel, the president of the NWA, has just informed me, as I said, the suspension against Blackjack Mulligan has been lifted. He has paid a $2,000 fine. Secondly, there was a suspension pending against Kevin Sullivan. Mr. Mulligan agreed to drop his suit against the NWA if he would, in fact, not suspend Kevin Sullivan. He said he wants Kevin Sullivan. The only way he can get him legally is going to be in the ring. So, Mr. Sullivan is back in action, although he's never been out of action, technically. And I see that he has joined us here now.
Darkness has laid a long time in the bones. Evil has laid dormant for a long time. The haze himself, when he came from the sea, has laid dormant. Neha Singh, who was laid in the streets with the lepers and the beggars, has laid dormant. All hell is about to break loose. Road Warriors, I defy you all. Mulligan, Wahoo, and the man back from the desert himself, Superstar Graham, reborn, rekindled, and to relive again. No! I said for 2 weeks, the reign of terror would start. Road warriors were starting real clear. I am going to destroy everything and everybody in my path because evil lives once more. Just when you thought it was safe to come to Florida, my heart has turned back to darkness. Abunadeen himself has showed me the way. This time, the spike will be returned. And I want to make one thing clear. I know some people in this commentary table have something to do with the promotion. They had something to do with the Road Warriors coming back. Accidents happen.
We're going to be seeing Kevin Sullivan and Bob Roop in action. And as you heard, of course, a bit of, if you will, plea bargaining going on with Blackjack Mulligan and the board of directors of the NWA. Mulligan's suspension has been lifted, and Kevin Sullivan is now going to have to face the wrath of Blackjack Mulligan whenever and wherever he can get his hands on him. And we do have a match upcoming right now. I think it's time to turn it over to our ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match is one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing first, accompanied to the ring by Luna from Boston, Massachusetts, weighing in at 242 pounds, here's Kevin Sullivan. And his partner hails from Calcutta, India, weighs in at 280 pounds, Meha Singh. And their opponents, first from Tampa, Florida, weighing in at 240 pounds, here's Mike Allen. And from New Orleans, weighing in at 235 pounds, here's Brickhouse Brown. One fall with a 10-minute time limit.
And so, it is Kevin Sullivan and Bob Roop, Maya Singh, as he prefers to be known. In there against Mike Allen and Brickhouse Brown, and it's Allen in trouble right now as Roop has him securely pinned against the ropes. Now Kevin Sullivan moves into the ring, and a bit of double teaming here, buddy.
Well, you know, one big problem that most wrestlers have against a team like Kevin Sullivan and Bob Roop is they try and wrestle these men. You can't try and wrestle them. There was a big shoulder breaker. Well, that shoulder breaker with Bob Roop, it has to be all over for Mike Allen. And there was a three count. It was quite a victory for Bob Roop and Kevin Sullivan, but their tactics are questionable.
Well, they are indeed. And so the team of Sullivan and Roop are victorious over Allen and Brickhouse Brown, and we'll be right back. Of course, as you know, the television tournament matches are being held throughout the entire state of Florida. And we do have a TV tournament match right now. Should be an outstanding one. By the way, some great matches tomorrow night in Sarasota. And, of course, Kevin Sullivan will be in Nassau tonight. You'll be seeing him in action there. And now let's go to our ring announcer for this TV tourney match.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is our second match in our Florida TV title tournament. Introducing first from Port-au-Prince, Haiti, he weighs in at 216 pounds. Presently the champion of the Bahama Islands, the Haitian sensation, Terrible T. Tyree Pride. And his opponent hails from St. Petersburg, Florida, is the former Florida heavyweight champion. Here he is at 228 pounds, Jack the Stretcher Hart. One fall with a 10-minute time limit.
And one fall with a 10-minute time limit on this. This is a TV elimination tournament match for the TV title. This is, of course, Tyree Pride, the Bahamian champion, going up against former Florida heavyweight champion Jack Hart. Nice series of drop kicks on the part of Tyree Pride, and out of the ring goes Jack Hart to try and reconnoiter, get his foot back, slow things down. Referee counting, coming back in, slowly circling. Locking up. Referee very close and well backing into the ropes. Referee calling for a break. This, of course, is for the elimination match for the TV championship. There are TV title matches going on throughout the state for the elimination tournament. This is not the only place there are elimination tournaments.
Good reversal that time by Tyree Pride, the Bahamas champion, as he got in behind Jack Hart. Jack Hart, of course, a former amateur champion here in the state of Florida. Out of St. Petersburg, and is quite a competitor. He's got his hands full with Tyree. Of course, if this match goes a 10-minute draw, they're both eliminated.
That's right, so you have to have a lot of fast action. So in these TV elimination tournament matches, you will see a lot of fast moving because you have got to get a pinfall inside of that 10-minute time limit there. Because, Leslie, you know, all TV matches are normally with a 10-minute time limit, so the TV title has to be with a 10-minute time limit. So that's why many times for these type of tournament matches, you will see each opponent, each competitor going all out, giving it 110% to try and gain that pinfall within 10 minutes. There's Tyree Pride with an arm bar on Jack Hart. Referee just leaning down, but this is not a submission hold. It puts a lot of pressure on that upper shoulder, on that deltoid muscle there. But it is not a submission hold. It just wears down that arm.
Back up into the ring ropes now. The referee, Del Alfonso, calling for the break. Tyree tried to cover up, but Hart caught him. Then Hart catches him once again, an elbow to the midsection. First, he can cut down the air supply to Tyree Pride. He'll cut down some of that sensational speed that he has. High, high hip toss by Tyree. Beautiful arm drag. Really, that was a spin under. But that Tyree Pride is about as fast a competitor as I've ever seen.
Well, he is a sensational athlete. This man is right up there with the very best in the world. He can compete with anybody at all. You know, he's held that Bahamian title championship now for several months. He has defended that title extensively throughout the state of Florida and in the Bahama Islands and always come out on top. So this would be a good competitor. This man, he's right up on top there for the TV title, too. Once again, he's back on that arm bar of Jack Hart, really working on that arm, trying to wear it down. If you can partially disable one section of your opponent's body, I'll tell you, everything's going to go your way. And so the smart wrestler will normally concentrate on one part of the body and keep going back after it. Now backing in the ropes, referee calling for a break. Tyree Pratt's going to have to be very careful here. Well, he wasn't quite careful enough.
Hart has stung him twice on the ropes now. And now it's Hart, bottom wrist lock on Tyree Pride. Now Hart goes to the hammerlock instead of the lateral drop. And now he locks that arm and now comes across. Well, he's really across the throat. And the referee, Bill Alfonso, very quickly and very alertly separating that from the throat. Now back to an arm bar. So Hart, who I would have thought would have gone to a lateral drop, did not. And Tyree Pride is turning that to his own advantage now. The beautiful leg pickup. And Hart's got some problems, buddy.
Right, for a minute there, it looked like Jack Hart was doing quite well. But Tyree Pride, having that huge array of wrestling moves and maneuvers, was able to reverse it and come back. And once again, Jack Hart is backing up, trying to slow down, but he can't slow down too much because that clock is always moving and there is only 10 minutes. And if one man doesn't get a pinfall, they are both eliminated from the tournament. And along with that TV title comes a lot of prestige, and of course, the main thing is more money.
All right, they lock up collar and elbow once again, and it is Tyree Pride now with a side headlock on Jack Hart.
Well, there's Tyree Pride with a side headlock. Now, sometimes a side headlock can be dangerous if you don't really have yourself set. You have to watch your balance because this can very easily be turned into a back suplex play, which it looks like Jack Hart might be trying for. But no, Tyree Pride was too smart for him there.
Walked the ropes and took him over, and once again, Jack Hart feels the sting of that canvas on his back. And now it's Hart getting the head scissors on Tyree Pride. Pride rolling into his man now. Let's see if he's able to extricate himself from it. Tries to headstand out, blocked by Hart. All right, Hart. Keeping the pressure. Notice the way he's got those trunks. All right, the referee, Bill Alfonso, alertly picked up on that. Again, Tyree does power out from that headstand, and a very frustrated Jack Hart.
Well, after Tyree Pride kicked out the headstand, now, to me, I think he should have gone right back very quickly for a side headlock. It gave Jack Hart a little time to think. Well, a big high knee on the upper chest of Tyree Pride, and that really did slow him down a lot. And a foot right into the midsection. Big high knee lift. Looks like Tyree Pride, the Bahamian champion, is in a lot of trouble right now. So those fingers going to the eyes of Tyree Pride, partially blinding him, making his eyes watery. Hard to see.
Hart setting him. Gets a vertical suplex, and he may have the pinfall here. Lateral body press, but to no avail as Pride came out of it. Hart powers away with a hard right hand.
Well, and once again, another big right. And Tyree Pride coming right back with a big right. Another right to the head of Jack Hart. Looks like Jack Hart is wobbling. He's dazed. He's going down.
Those legs went to rubber. Tyree Pride now an Irish whip into the far turnbuckle. Pride catches it. High foot to the center of the ring. Tyree Pride moves in on his man once again. Hart drives a shoulder to the midsection of Tyree. Tyree, of course, the Bahamas champion. Jack Hart drops to the canvas. And Hart tried to set him. And Pride got him. Hart tried to set him up. Tried to catch him. It ain't Flint Man instead. It was Tyree Pride hooking those legs very cleverly. Brought Hart over, those shoulders were down, and so Pride gets the pinfall. As I said, of course, earlier in the program, that I was wearing the Löwenbräu Grand Prix of Miami hat, that I had some very special guests with me. I'd like to introduce them, if I may, at this time. I have Mr. Joel Doliner from the Sports Incorporation itself, from Miami Sports Incorporated. And alongside of him, the fellow who's known as the Canadian ace, Bill Adams. Here's a fellow who has an outstanding record in IMSA racing. In fact, it was what? You won three of them in 83 in one team, went to another team, won again in 84 and 85?
That's right. Back then, I was with the Jaguar team. We had a very successful season. It was very gratifying to go through a development period with a car like that and finally come out a winner.
Let me ask you this, Bill. Now, of course, the Grand Prix is going to be held in Miami, and this year you're going to have a different car.
Yes, this year I'm going to be in an American engine car. It runs a very small Buick V6, very similar to what you'd get in a car you drive on the street. And with the help of a turbocharger, it puts out something over 900 horsepower. So you can
900
imagine.
900 horses?
Absolutely staggering.
That is something indeed. Joel, let me turn to you right now. How about the dates for the Grand Prix? Because it's a split deal this year.
Yes, sir. For the first time, IMSA Racing's going to two weekends in Miami or anywhere itself. February 22nd and 23rd, March 1st and 2nd, on a brand new racetrack in Miami.
Of course, Löwenbräu is one of the sponsors, and I understand the tickets are available at all Rolls Auto stores.
Yes, that's right.
Now, Bill, I understand, too, that you're going to be back, that you have a special interest in Wahoo McDaniel's World Heavyweight Championship match.
That's right. I'll be in Miami on the 12th at the Miami Convention Center to watch Ric Flair take on Wahoo. And it's going to have all of the excitement we've got here today, and I'm sure more. I'm really looking forward to it, just to get out and talk to people about the Grand Prix as well. If any of your viewers care to come over and say hi and any questions, I'd be very, very happy to meet with them.
Would you be available to sign autographs or have photos taken or anything like that?
Absolutely. I'd be very happy to.
All right, Joel, I would assume that you're looking for another sensational crowd this year.
Yes, we're looking for a big crowd this year in Miami. Once again, the highest paying race in the IMSA circuit, and we're real happy that it's going along very well for us.
Okay, thank you so very much, Joel and Bill. A pleasure to have you here on Championship Wrestling. And, of course, you'll be getting a chance to meet Bill personally at the Miami Beach Convention Center on the 12th when Wahoo McDaniel goes after Ric Flair in the World Heavyweight Championship. The Road Warriors will be there and a host of others, and we'll be back in just a minute. Lady Maxine has returned to the Florida scene, and she's joined me here at the desk. Nice to see you back, but may I ask you, what is this?
This is the hardest rendering of a lunatic, the female that I've been brought back in to wrestle with and take care of, just like I did the others before her.
All right, fair enough. Stay with me during this match, if you will, please. And let's go now to our ring announcer.
This match is one fall with a 10-minute time limit. Introducing first from Portland, Oregon, he weighs 267 pounds. presently the Southern Heavyweight Champion. Here he is, Bulldog Jesse Barr. And his opponent hails from Laguna Beach, California. He weighs 237 pounds. Here's Jerry Gray. One fall with a 10-minute time limit.
There's the bell now. Jerry Gray getting set to move out against Jesse Barr. Jesse Barr, the Southern Heavyweight Wrestling Champion. Barr very quickly. A nice back out by Gray as he slipped away from it. Barr went for an ankle sweep. Barr duck under. It'll be a night waist lift takedown. And Jerry Gray attempting to sit out, hook that good chicken wing, and that separated him once from Jesse Barr. Yeah, a lot of people I've noticed, by the way, I wanted to say something. You mentioned it just now, but I understand that Miss Luna is very upset that people in the arenas have been calling her lunatic. And I really suppose I should admonish everyone that they shouldn't do that because it does upset her.
Well, Gordon, I don't care if it upsets her or not. It's the truth. And the fact is, I really think the NWA should intervene in this and ban insane people from wrestling in the ring because it's not a safe thing. You know, you don't really know what they're going to do. Sometimes their strength is greater than the average person. And, you know, I'm just going to have to keep my eyes open for her and make sure that her partners that she's aligned herself with will, you know, I'm going to take a back seat to the action that's
going to
happen between me and her.
Fair enough. Lady Maxine, and it's Jerry Gray. That's a full-arm drag and twist now by Jesse Barr.
Well, you know, the last time I saw Jerry Gray prior to him coming back here to Florida was probably about a year or so ago, and this man has really improved tremendously. He is now a top-class competitor. You see right now, he's been holding his own very well with Jesse Barr, and that is such a good ball. You saw Jesse Barr got off balance there. Jerry tried for a side hip toss. It was reversed on the part of Jesse Barr. Jesse Barr hip toss, and Jerry coming up with an arm drag takedown. Jesse coming out on top. But I tell you, Jerry Gray has so greatly improved over the last few years that he has got himself up there with the very best of the competitors anywhere in the world.
Back up against the ropes once again. Jerry Gray hits with that elbow, and it's Barr. Had him in a high vertical body block. Gray started to climb to the canvas. Barr caught the front of that rope on his throat. That has slowed him down, and Gray is quick to take advantage of that opportunity.
Well, it looks like Jerry Gray knew exactly what he was doing when he lifted Jesse Barr up there and dropped his throat across that. Now a back suplex here. And Jesse Barr is down, and right now this could be a pinfall for Jerry Gray. If Jerry Gray can get a pinfall over Jesse Barr, I'll tell you, that puts him right in line for a Southern Heavyweight title shot, a title shot. There would be no stopping Jerry Gray if he can defeat Jesse Barr, and he is well on the way right now. Jesse Barr is in a lot of trouble at the hands of Jerry Gray.
Gray, gutman salto, well executed into a cross-body press, and it is the Barr pulling out of it once again. Amazing, too, because Barr is the Greco-Roman specialist. And look at Gray, bring him up again, another full body slam. Barr rolls away from this one.
Nice snap there on the part of Jesse Barr. This match has been going back and forth. These two competitors are very evenly matched. Everyone knows the ability of Jesse Barr. You can't speak enough of that. Well, right there, well, it looks like Jerry Gray made a bad mistake, running right straight into that big knee of Jesse Barr. That slowed him down a lot. You have to be very careful when you're going up against a well-seasoned veteran and ring general like Jesse Barr.
Barr, who is in his sixth year as a professional athlete. Gray. And Gray dumped him over that top rope. Referee calling for the bell. The referee calling for the bell. Barr right back into the ring after Gray. And Gray scooting from the ring. He was automatically disqualified when he dumped Jesse Barr over the top rope. But Gray gave quite an accounting of himself. And Lady Maxine, all I can say is welcome back and good luck. That Luna is something else.
Thank you very much, Gordon. I consider this is my banana award because I consider her a real lunatic. And Luna, I hope you're watching because that's you.
Fair enough.
Got it?
Back.
Introducing first the team to my right. From the great state of Florida with a combined weight of 476 pounds, here's Stanley Lane and Steve Kern, the Fabulous Ones.
And their opponents first, from Atlanta, Georgia, weighing in at 257 pounds, here's Dino Minelli. And his partner hails from the Isle of Hawaii, weighs in at 246 pounds, here's Prince Iaukea. One fall with a 10-minute time limit.
All right, the fabulous ones going up against Dino Minelli and Prince Iaukea. One fall, 10-minute time limit. Stan Lane and Steve Kern.
Well, Gordon, you know, when I first came to Florida to wrestle in 1972, Steve Kern was just getting started then. Right now, I think it's the first time that Steve has been back here in about 5 or 6 years, and he has really come a long way. He's made a real name for himself in professional wrestling circles. He's, along with his partner, Stan Lane, they are a world-renowned tag team combination. They are two of the tops that you will ever see compete anywhere in the whole world. And I think Steve Kern has really made a great name for himself, and it's really proud to know that he's right here from Tampa.
Certainly is. Obviously, Tampa has produced a host of great, great competitors. Talking about Steve Kern, of course, Mike Graham, Dick Slater, and you could go on down the line. By the way, Mike mentioned, too, we're saddened to hear of... good drop toehold. Good drop toehold and up on his man. He's got a bar on that arm, and so Dino Minnelli's got his problems. And Kern came in with a ravaging forearm into the lumbar region of the back.
Well, you know, when two men such as this, they train together, work out together, travel together, they really know each other's moves, practically each other's thoughts. This really gives you a decided advantage in a tag team combination. These two have been a tag team combination for many years now, and I don't think you'll see a more coordinated tag team than the team of Steve Kern and Stan Lane, the fabulous ones. I'm really expecting some great things from them here in Florida, and I'm sure all of you wrestling fans are going to see some terrific action for these two men.
Minelli locks up collar and elbow, forearm drag and twist now by Kern. Kern into a bottom wrist lock, makes the tag. Stan Lane moves in. Waddle drop, got a little assist there when he grabbed the trunks. Can't say that I blame him.
Well, it looks like the referee is admonishing Stan Lane and Steve Kern, warning them. The fans are hollering no. Looks like Minelli was complaining about someone grabbing the trunks or doing something that perhaps he shouldn't have done. But then you always have some crybabies everywhere. Stan Lane with that full armbar and twist. Step over, it looks like a leg pick up, and down he goes with arm stretch here. This can be a painful hold. It's really stretching the arm. It's like pulling the arm out of the socket at the shoulder muscle. Like Minelli struggling with his feet. Well, and raking his eyes, he's able to get himself free from that.
He's got him in trouble now.
Well, there's the trap going right on, head on with Stan Lane. He's really trying to get him down. He's going to have to keep him over, close this corner. Stan Lane fighting back, coming up with that right to the chin of the Prince. Back over to his corner, sagging and tagging out to Steve Kern. Looks like he tables up Kern, and right now the Prince is in a lot of trouble. Steve Kern staying right on top of the Prince.
Steve Kern has the Prince up. Full body slam on Prince Iaukea. Looking extremely strong right now. Iaukea was tough enough to pull away from a possible winning combination.
Well, that's quite a move on the part of Steve Kern, reversing that head system into a possible pinning combination. What a very fast, smart thinking. Splitting those legs there. Putting the pressure in that upper thigh muscles. Well, you see the Prince smartly rolling over, tagging out, trying to get that fresh man in. Good drop toe hold. Looks like he's coming up with a reverse chin lock and ride.
Well, Kern and Lane are beginning to let out all the stops now as they're firing of the tactics of Dino Minelli and Prince Iaukea. The tag was made. Minelli not aware of the tag. Catches Kern coming off the ropes. Wow!
just caught him with a kick coming off the ropes, put him down for the count. A very, very explosive team. The fabulous ones, Steve Kern and Stan Lane, are the victors.
You know, I think one of the most important things on your mind, Kendall, is that the suspension on your dad has been lifted. How do you feel about that?
Well, you know, buddy, it's great. The suspension on my dad's been lifted, you know. He tried to take the NWA to court. He tried to sue him. He lifted his suit. He was going to have Kevin Sullivan suspended. You know, now things are working out for the better. His suspension's been lifted, and Kevin Sullivan has got to face him in the ring sometime or another.
You know, the easy way out for Sullivan might have been for Sullivan to be suspended, but your dad didn't want Sullivan suspended. Your dad, Blackjack, he wanted Sullivan in the ring where he can get hold of him. He had been suspended. Then Sullivan would not have had to pay his dues. Now he's got to pay those dues.
That's right, buddy. You know, sometimes, someplace, Kevin Sullivan, you know, karma, you talk about karma. Karma's coming. You know, you do things to me. You come in, you burn my face, you cripple my neck, you run people into barricades. You know, buddy, I got a tape right here I'd like to show. Another reason why I think Kevin Sullivan should have been suspended, but you got to pay your dues. I'd like to show what they've done to superstar Billy Graham.
Let's go to that tape now.
Wait a minute. Superstar Billy Graham just put a stop to that.
First of all, Kevin Sullivan, I want you to know that I am alive and I am well. I am not in an Egyptian tomb in Cairo. I am not dwelling with the headhunters on the Amazon River. I am not in the jungles of Borneo and Sumatra with the prehistoric pygmies.
Now, this tape has been buried in the desert of Cambridge.
That's why it's not your television set. It's not the at the expense of the television station. The quality of the film, you understand, has been buried in the desert where superstar Billy Graham was resurrected after that attempted assassination on the life of superstar Billy Graham by the devil himself, Kevin Sullivan, and Purple Haze. And all the rest of his disciples, take a close look. You see how he turned on me. He might turn on you. But let me lay something heavy on you, Kevin Sullivan. Superstar Billy Graham laid in the desert and paid the price with the scorpions crawling across my face and in my mouth, with the vipers snapping at my side, with the Gila monsters taking chunks out of my flesh. Day and night, I laid there until the devil was gone. Until Kevin Sullivan was gone from superstar Billy Graham. Now I'm alive and well, and I've come back to get you, Kevin Sullivan. The bells are going to toll. Lakeland on the 15th. Superstar Billy Graham and the 24-inch pythons will be in Lakeland on the 15th. And I'm here to tell you that the bells are going to toll for the master of the door, for the man who holds the keys, the key keeper, Kevin Sullivan.
You know, Sullivan, you've lost your golden spike, and now on top of the Road Warriors and Wahoo McDaniel, you have Billy Graham hot on your tail. And then, Wahoo, tell me, right now, with Sullivan has lost his golden spike, Blackjack Mulligan is being reinstated. What's going to happen to Sullivan?
Well, you've got the Road Warriors, you've got Mulligan, you've got superstar Billy Graham, you've got Kendall, you've got myself. And like I said, Blackjack's coming back. And not only that, Barry Windham will be back here next week from a triumphant tour in Japan. So you've got six or seven guys here. It's now or never for you, Sullivan. So you better get all your disciples, you better get a little bigger group, and you better get them ready. Because we're all coming. We're all going to help one another. You'll be laying in the desert. It'll be the snakes crawling over you, and it'll be the tree of woe that you're strapped to.
You know, Sullivan, you and the devil's cult just may not be enough because you have too many men out to get you. And I tell you, I'm cheering for all of them.
Let me say one thing before we go. I really believe that destiny has it that your face, Kevin Sullivan, is in the hands of superstar Billy Graham and the Python.
Our next match is one fall with television time remaining. Introducing first from Tampa, Florida, weighing in at 215 pounds, here's Del Apollo. And his opponent hails from Chicago, Illinois. He weighs in at 281 pounds, here's Lex Luger. One fall, television time remaining.
Lex Luger, and what a figure he cuts when he gets into that ring. Massively muscled man, yet perfectly proportioned. Going up against Del Apollo, who's giving away a tremendous amount of weight and size. But other than that, they're really, in a sense, cut from the same mold as far as muscular definition and confirmation goes.
That's right. You can't take anything away from the development of Del Apollo. He's just perhaps a smaller version of Lex Luger. But Lex Luger weighs in 280 pounds of rock-hard solid muscle. And having the wrestling ability that this man possesses on top of it, I have to definitely give the nod to Lex Luger. This Lex Luger is second to none in the wrestling world. You know, I was watching the Mr. Olympia physique contest on television, and Lex Luger looked as good as the winner of the 1986 Mr. Olympia contest. And this man not only has the physique, he has the intestinal fortitude. He has the body conditioning, the endurance of a wrestler that many weightlifters don't have. Lex Luger has really got it all. Just look at the muscles on this man. And right now holding a hammerlock. And when he's got a hammerlock on you, he can put some pressure on it. So now it's going to be up to Del Apollo to try and come out with a nice reversal on the part of Apollo. Like I said, do not underestimate Del Apollo. This is an accomplished wrestler. And reversed once again on the part of Lex Luger.
Luger brings him up to the ring ropes, and it's Luger punishing Apollo coming off of those ropes. And Apollo's upper body now considerably reddened from the percussions that he has taken to the back. Irish whip into the ropes once again. Luger caught him with a knee coming in. When you stop to think about it, some of the great competitors that are going to be in Florida in the weeks to come, the NWA World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair. Luger has a rematch for that Southern Heavyweight title against Jesse Barr. Rick Rude returning. Of course, the fabulous one, Steve Kern and Stan Lane. The Road Warriors, Precious Paul Ellering. Abdullah the Butcher has been here. I'll tell you, the state of Florida is being values are some of the greatest competitors in the sport today.
That's right, Dan. Another man we're looking for. Well, looks like Del Apollo just submitted that worthy submission hole, and it's all over for Del Apollo. You know, Gordon, another man that will be returning that could very well be the next world's champion is Barry Windham.
No question about it. Let me see if I can get Lex Luger over here for just a moment. Now, he disappeared before I could catch him. And,
Mr. Solie, I would like to say something real clear. It seems the armies have joined forces. The Road Warriors, Wahoo McDaniels, Blackjack Mulligan. I'm not afraid of anybody, any place, any time, but Superstar Grimm. You understand? You went to the desert to purge yourself from me. You can never purge yourself from darkness, Billy Graham. You were the one that decided to step over to my side. You see, Billy Graham, once you took that step, you can tell everybody you've been reborn and the original superstar is back. The original superstar died in the desert. He went and he terminated himself when he went with Abu Dean. Billy Graham, you didn't just turn your back on me. You turned your back on a way of life that was given to you by Habuda Dean and Og. You were taken to the gate. You were seen with Og. You were taken to the river of dead, and you gave up your identity. Now, Billy Graham, you're talking about Lakeland on the 15th. Billy Graham, it's this clear. When you died once in the desert, you'll return, and this time, the vultures will pluck your skin up.
Well, I think he said quite enough. By the way, I would like to point out that according to the pairings now, next week we'll be seeing Lex Luger go up against Hector Guerrero
in the ongoing television tournament. Boy, what a match that's going to be.
Well, I tell you, that will be an exciting match to watch. It'll be fast-paced, and there'll be a lot of wrestling going on.
No question about it. Great wrestling going on throughout the entire state. So if you get an opportunity, always remember you go with the best when you go with the NWA, the oldest and largest sanctioning body of professional wrestling the world over. And I can assure you that in the weeks to come, you're going to be seeing tremendous examples of that throughout the entire state. Florida, and don't forget, of course, the big Battle of the Belts coming up in Orlando. Blackout in Orlando, but it'll be carried elsewhere. Until next week, so long.